Hi there. In a recent video, I explained that I ditched the troublesome and unstable setup of two transformers followed by a rectifier to get high DC voltage for testing multimeters and replaced it with a stable DC to DC converter. If you have not seen the video, I put a link in the screen now. While this works nice for testing DC, I have now lost the capability of testing high voltage AC. In this video, I want to show how to create high voltage AC out of the stable DC to fill that gap. You may think, why not use mains directly? But that has a couple of problems. First, it's not without danger probing mains directly, and especially if you are doing this to find out if a suspect multimeter is still working correctly. Secondly, mains delivers just one test case, which is between 230 volts and 240 volts AC here in the UK, and of course the value is not stable. Instead of mains, I want to create a DC to AC converter that is driven by a stable but selectable DC voltage, which can be of course pretty high. If the DC input voltage is stable, the AC output voltage should then also be stable. The frequency of the AC should be selectable, but it doesn't need to be super accurate. If I want to verify the accuracy of the frequency readout of a multimeter, I use a frequency generator directly. In the UK we are using 50 Hz, so I'm thinking 50 Hz, 100 Hz and possibly 400 Hz, or maybe an externally provided frequency. But the converter circuit should be able to do 60 and 120 Hz for those who rather need those frequencies instead. The output should be a square wave with 50% duty cycle. I selected this for a couple of reasons. It's much easier to produce than a clean sine wave. Its RMS value is easy to predict. It's the same as the peak voltage if the duty cycle is 50%. That is, the duration of the positive pulse is the same length as the duration of the negative one. Using a square wave will show if a multimeter does true RMS measurements or is using averaging instead. I made several videos about true RMS and averaging meters if you're interested. One last point. On all my projects I do a buy or build comparison, and if there's a module out there that does what I want, I usually go for the buy, because in these days of mass production in China you can't even get all the components for the price of a ready-made module. Well, it looks like all the DC to AC converter modules you can buy are all optimized for powering main stuff from batteries, and so they are fixed frequency, fixed voltage, and their output waveform is sometimes sine, but most often a mix of square waves approximating sine wave. They are not suitable for this project, so in this case I'm going to use a true build from scratch. Here's what I came up with as a high-level diagram. We start on the left with an oscillator producing a square wave of about 800 Hz, or if you want 960 Hz for frequencies that are multiples of 60 Hz. But I'm using the 800 Hz for the rest of this discussion. Next, this generated square wave enters a four-stage frequency divider using flip-flops. Each flip-flop divides by 2, so the first flip-flop produces 400 Hz, the next 200, and so on until 50 Hz on the last flip-flop. The main reason for using this approach is that it guarantees 50% duty cycle on those four frequencies, regardless of what duty cycle the 800 Hz oscillator may have. A nice side effect is that any deviation from 800 Hz is also divided and thus reduced at each stage. For example, if the 800 Hz oscillator is off by 16 Hz and runs at 816 Hz, then the 50 Hz are only off by 1 Hz. The selected frequency, which could also be external, goes into a driver circuit and is split into two channels that are 180 degrees out of phase. In other words, one is the inverted wave from the other. This is simply done by using inverters, and one channel has one inverter more than the other. The last part is the business end. It consists of a circuit known as an H-bridge from the way the components are arranged. In this diagram I'm showing these as relay switches, but in reality they are of course MOSFETs, as mechanical relays won't be able to cope with the frequencies we need. The important part is that each of the two driver channels drives two switches, but they are diagonally opposed from each other. Assume for a moment that the upper DC in is positive and the lower one is negative. In reality, their polarity doesn't matter, but it helps in understanding how the H bridge works. If the signal from the selected frequency is high, the upper channel output is also high. It closes the upper left and lower right switch, while the other two switches are open because the lower channel output is low. This switch configuration means the positive DC in is connected to the left AC out and the negative one to the right one. When the signal from the selected frequency goes low, the upper channel becomes low and opens its switches, while the lower channel output becomes high, so now the upper right and lower left switches are closed. The AC output has reversed its polarity, and this repeats at the selected frequency, so you have an AC square wave output. Under any circumstances, we must avoid ever closing two switches on the same side at the same time, because that would short-circuit the DC in supply. The first thing to put together is the oscillator using the venerable 555 timer chip. There are many web resources to help with that. An easy one is this one, circuitdigest.com. It shows the standard unstable circuit diagram of the 555, where the frequency depends on C1, R1 and R2. By experimenting a bit using standard components in the part bin, we can enter 0.1 microfarad or 100 nF for the capacitor, 1000 ohms for R1 and 8200 ohms for R2, hit calculate and get the frequency of 829 Hz. Of course, you could reverse the formula yourself and calculate the exact value of R2 for a specific frequency, but with a bit trial and error using this program, it's easy to find that an R2 of 8510 ohms will get you almost exactly there. And of course, for those wanting 60 Hz, we need a frequency of 960 Hz instead, changing R2 to 6800 ohms gets you 988. Better would be, of course, 7010 ohms. Here's the complete schematic in KiCad, which you can find in my GitHub page. Links in the description in the video. It may look complex, but it's just a refinement of the high-level diagram I showed earlier. Here is the 555 timer-based oscillator. R2 is the resistor that determines the frequency. I show here 8.2K for the 50 Hz version, and you need to change to 6.8K for 60 Hz. I decided to stick with standard values instead of 8.5K or 7K because 5% tolerance of a resistor of 8.2K is already plus minus 410 ohm, and capacitors have usually at least 10 and often 20% tolerance. My hope was that using standard values, the frequency would be close enough. An option, of course, would be using a trim pot for R2 and thus make the frequency adjustable, but in the end I decided it wasn't worth the effort. I did come to regret that later, as you will see. The 4-stage flip-flop divider is an 74LS93. I decided to not use 200 Hz, so that frequency isn't connected to the pin header for the selector switch, but you may decide differently, of course. The other end of the switch is the pad marked frequency, which leads to the driver, in this case a 74HC00 quad NAND chip, because I had many of those left in the parts bin. The driver connects to the H bridge, for which I use 4 Photomos relays from Panasonic. More about these in a moment, but for now notice that they are optocoupled, so each driver simply drives two LEDs in series with a 410 ohm current limiting resistor. Each LED has a voltage drop of around 1.25 volts, so together 2.5 volts, which means at 5 volts a 470 ohm resistor will limit the current through the two LEDs to 5.3 milliamps. This is somewhat important, as I will explain in a moment. The optocoupling means the H-bridge is completely isolated from the rest of the circuit, which is important because of the high voltages involved. The circuit itself gets its power through a standard 5-volt regulator with a few decoupling capacitors. it only uses a couple of milliamps. Let's have a quick look at the Photomos relay datasheet. As you can see, you can get this in dual inline housing, and all four of them fit neatly into a standard 16-pin dual inline socket. I'm using the 214 type, which is rated to switch 400 volts, 120 milliamps AC or DC. If we look a bit further down, you can see that there's a delay in the output when turning the LED on or off. T-on is the time for the output to become active and T-off the time to turn back off. A closer look in the table here for the 214 variant shows the T-on time to be typical 0.5 milliseconds, while the T-off time is 0.08 milliseconds, around an order of magnitude faster. This is very good news because in our age bridge, it means the switches will have guaranteed turned off before the opposite ones can turn on. One last note, initially I missed these two diagrams here, which show how the T-on and T-off timing depends on the LED current. For the 214, T-on increases quite a bit below 5 milliamps, while T-off isn't that all affected. When I initially built the circuit, I used 1K resistors, and so the LED current was only 2.5 milliamps. It worked fine, of course, but with more pronounced rising slopes in the square waveform. It is fixed now, but you may still see the wrong resistor values in some of the early footage. This oversight is even more embarrassing since I went to the trouble of building and testing the whole circuit on breadboard first. On this breadboard, the four Photomos relays are on the top, still with 1K resistors. Below is the 74HC00 driver, and below that the 74LS93 divider. The next section below is that voltage regulator, and at the very bottom the 555 oscillator. To simplify wiring, I'm driving the H bridge with the same 12 volts DC as the rest of the circuit, and so the multimeter shows an AC voltage of 11.79, which is slightly less than the expected value because of the deformed square wave due to the low LED current. The frequency happens to be almost spot on, 49.94 Hz, using standard resistor and capacitors. By selecting a different output of the divider, it can be changed to roughly 200 Hz, 100 Hz, or 400 Hz. This is how the 50 Hz signal from the breadboard looks on the scope using 12 volts as DC in. The deformation of the square wave due to the T-on delay and the low LED current is definitely visible. And here is the 100 Hz waveform with an even more pronounced deformation. As a consequence, the RMS value drops even more. And of course, the 400 Hz waveform is even worse. Here is the same test after doubling the LED current. The 50 Hz signal looks pretty good, and we have almost the theoretical RMS value. The 100 Hz waveform is still almost perfect in shape and shows nearly the same RMS. Even the 400 Hz wave is mostly square, reflected by the tiny drop of the RMS. Changing the LED current limiting resistor was definitely worth doing. My normal method for one-off projects like this is to place the components on perf board or Vero board based on experience and or gut feeling and wire them up based on the schematics. But that would not be very helpful for you, my viewers, if you want to build one yourself. So, as my first attempt to get more organized, I tried a free program for Vero and perf boards called Vero Root, which is available for Windows and Linux. I'm not going over how this program works, that would be a separate video, and if you're interested, leave some comments and I might consider it. Anyway, for the AC converter, you end up with a properly routed board layout like this. Each color truck represents a particular signal or net and is imported from the schematics. Yes, it still shows 1K resistors. This is basically the perf board version. The idea is you just solder the components in and then wire them up as shown using fine wire. You can make a version for Vero boards either vertical like here or horizontal. This I found a bit disappointing because it relies on you cutting tracks between, not at holes. You can see this everywhere. The black things, by the way, are solder bridges you need to add. If you're familiar with Vero boards, the standard way to break a track on a Vero board is that you basically twirl a hand tool that looks a bit like a drill bit with very shallow cutting angle in a hole until it has cut away the copper surrounding the hole. These two parts are now isolated from each other. What the Vero root program expects you to do is to cut like this. I found that very difficult, maybe because I don't have the right chiseling tools and practice. The advantage is, of course, that all holes remain usable for components, so a Vero board cut that way is as compact as a perf board or a proper PCB. In the end, I decided to go with perf board, and yes, working from a picture like this makes it much easier. I started by populating sockets for the IC and relays, positioning them as in the layout. I then did the same with the remaining components and connected everything up with solder bridges and wires underneath by looking at the printout from the Vero root program. I have already made a video about making this front panel printout, so I won't cover this here again. Anyway, you see that the switch for the frequency selection is missing, and it has only 50, 100 and external as positions. The reason for both is that I used this switch, which I already had, because it uses less space than a rotary switch. But as you can see, this switch is meant for PCB mounting and has no thread to fix it to a panel. So I came up with this metal strip, which I will superglue to the switch to provide a mounting bracket. Here's how that looks from the outside, nice and clean. From the rear, I superglued two M3 nuts onto the front panel to avoid having to drill holes and visible mounting screws. Then the mounting plate for the switch is simply screwed into these nuts, and as the screws were slightly too long, I put some washers in as well. A bit of a botch, but it works and you won't tell anybody. But if you're building this yourself, I highly recommend selecting another switch. With the switch sorted, the front panel can be wired up using Dupont female connectors for the pin headers on the board. And this is the completed unit. It's a fully wired up and functional self-contained unit, rather compact, and there isn't much spare room either. Everything works, of course, so job done. Just then I decided, for reason I may explain in another video, to start learning how to make proper PCBs, or rather Gerber files that you can send off to PCB manufacturers to make them for you. I decided to use KiCad for this, and what better project to start the learning process than the tried and true AC converter. As a manufacturer, I picked JLC PCB more or less randomly, and as a new customer you get some discounts, which makes this very affordable, provided you can wait 4 weeks for standard shipping, which I did. I think I paid less than £6, including shipping. Here's a view of the board component side. The whole layout strongly resembles the perf board version, which is no coincidence since I designed it as a one-to-one replacement. Okay, on the lower right I messed up positioning the silk screening and two labels are on top of each other. I can live with that. And some of the other printed component names will be covered up by components once they are mounted. I did not think about that. On the solder side is not much to see. My only regret is on the right, I should not have flooded the ground plane around the relays. After all, there's quite a bit of voltage there. I'm going through the assembly in time lapse, as the lowest height component resistors are first, followed by the sockets. I usually solder only one pin of each socket first to check if they are aligned properly before soldering the rest. Whether you use sockets or solder the chips indirectly is up to you. I prefer sockets because it makes testing a lot easier. Single pin headers are notoriously difficult to get straight, so I'm using a breadboard to keep these four straight and in the right position. Same method for these two power connectors. For the four pin headers in the middle, I can't use the breadboard because other stuff is in the way, but a piece of blue tack, or rather white tack, holds them in place long enough for the first pin to be soldered and the rest is then easy. The five polyester caps go in next. These three are close enough together to be held in position by the same white tack blob. Again, do one pin first, check alignment, and then do the others. The other ones have to be done one by one. The two electrolytic caps come next. They are tall enough to not require white tack for fixing, but again, I do one pin first, check alignment, and then the other. The last solder job is the regulator. The current draw is minute and any low power version will do. This one is already oversized. And there you have it, fully populated and ready for testing. The advantage of using sockets is that it allows putting the chips in one by one and testing each stage separately. The first test with no chips inserted is to apply 12 volts as input, current limited of course, and check the regulator by probing the 5 volt at each of the IC sockets. Everything is as it should be, that is a good start. After turning the power off first, I inserted the first chip, the 555, power back on and test the output, which is conveniently accessible at pin 14 of the socket for the divider. 2.3 volts, because it's actually AC, well, pulses. In AC mode, the meter shows 2.3 volts and 832 hertz. The timer works, but 833 hertz is quite a bit away from the planned 800 hertz. Obviously, in this case, the tolerances of standard resistors and capacitors did not work in my favor, but I worry about that later. Time to insert the divider and measure the 400 Hz output. It works, and with 832 Hz input, the 416 Hz is as expected. The 100 Hz output, well, 104 Hz. And the 50 Hz output now running at 52. But apart from the slightly too high frequency, everything is working as it should. To test the driver, I need to select one of the divider outputs and bridge it to the driver input. The white jumper cable is doing that, using the 50 Hz output. The meter is connected to one of the driver outputs at the relay socket. Yes, we get the 52 Hz. The other complementary driver output is also present. Since I only have four of the PhotoMOS relays, I'm going to raid the prototype and strip it of its relays. You can see the strong similarity between the two boards. The relays have been removed and now comes the slightly fiddly task to get them back into the socket of the new PCB. For the first test, I used the same 12 volt as the supply with a 50 milliamp or so current limit, so if there are any shorts due to layout errors, the relays won't be overloaded. Well, it turns out everything works just fine. 12 volt AC at 52.04 Hz. Time to do something about that annoying frequency error. Much better. How did I get there? You can see I desoldered the single 8.2K R2 and replaced it with two standing resistors of 8.2K and 300 ohm that are then bridged. Together that gives 8.5K, which works. Obviously the capacitor I picked for C6 happens to be almost exactly 100 NF and so the resistor has to be higher than 8.2K to bring the frequency down. Since this may be a bit hard to see, here's a rough drawing of what I did. Replacing R2 by two in series resistors R2A and R2B allows a much easier selection of the right resistance, which of course also depends on the tolerances of the capacitor C6. So how to pick R2A and R2B? Here's a recreation of the method I used. If R2 is out or never populated, the pads are fairly easy to be tapped with these common test leads with small alligator clips. Then you can power the board and play with resistor combinations until you get the value delivering the closest 800 or 960 Hz and solder them in. With that problem fixed, I unplugged the prototype and moved all wires to the new PCB instead. And here's the final result, ready to go into the housing. The final test using the DC high voltage source for supplying the H-bridge. From 85 volts AC to 208 volts AC, no problems, whether 50 Hz or 100 Hz. Even at 208 volts AC and 100 Hz, the DC content is just 0.15 volts, and testament to the accuracy of the 50% duty cycle and the switching speed of the Photomos relays. This means, of course, that the AC plus DC voltage is the same as the AC voltage, which is what I wanted. That said, nothing stops you from using an external generator and a different frequency or duty cycle. Here, the duty cycle is shown by the small meter. With 50%, we have about 50 mV DC at 200 volts AC. But change the duty cycle to 70%, for example, and we now have almost plus 80 volts DC offset on our 183 volts AC. And of course, going the other way to 30% and the DC offset reverses polarity. This is great for testing multimeter behavior with mixed DC and AC signals. Or take this test, sure to stress any auto-ranging multimeter. The duty cycle is back to 50%, but the frequency is just 0.5 Hz. Both meters struggle to auto-range to the correct value before the polarity reverses and they have to do it again. But both work fine when going to manual ranging. There are plenty of other applications, and remember, you don't have to use all of the H-bridge. Sometimes just one relay contact controlled via an optocoupled TTL signal on the external input is very useful to have. The PCB design, including the Gerber files and the schematics, are available on my GitHub page. I did a small modification to the PCB in removing the ground plane fill in the area of the H-bridge. Not that I had any issues, but I have only tested it to 208 volts so far. The other change is that I moved some of the component labels so they can still be seen after soldering the components in. And speaking of components, this bill of material for the PCB is also included in the description document at my GitHub page. On the right, you see some RS component stock numbers, but I'm pretty sure most of the stuff is easily available from all distributors. Depending on your plans, you may need additional things like an enclosure, binding post, selector switch, and so on. Well, that's about it for this video, except one thing. Since the minimum order of PCBs on JLC is 5, I still have some spare boards. These have, of course, none of the improvements I just mentioned, but they work fine as you have seen. So I'm giving 3 away. If you want one, send me an email with your address. I will pick 3 and send you an unpopulated PCB board free of charge. You find my email in my YouTube About page. Thanks for watching.